Blackstone presents Aurelia, Aurelia, a memoir by Kathryn Davis. This book is read by Kathryn Davis. For Louise. There is no other way to understand the procession of dachshunds that follows Kathryn's disastrous recital than as a looking glass into Kathryn's tempestuous soul. If we were to translate her soul into words, it would say, "Look at me. No, don't look at me. Look at those dogs instead." Miguel Morales. As everybody knows, one never sees the sun in one's dreams. Gerard de Nerval. Time passes. There are points in your life when you think you're about to become whatever's next. I was 16. I had read the entire Alexandria Quartet, and I thought I was an adult. I had read sentences like, "Watching her thus, trapped for a moment by a rare sunbeam on the dirty window pane, I could not help reflecting once more that in her there was nothing to control or modify the intuition which she had developed out of a nature gorged upon introspection, and had understood nothing except the stupendous effect the language had on me. Empty cadences of seawater, licking its own wounds, sulking along the mouths of the delta, boiling upon those deserted beaches. The first time I inhabited Alexandria, it was as a 16-year-old high school student living in Philadelphia. The second time as a 23-year-old married woman living on a Greek island. I was trying to teach myself demotic Greek using a pocket dictionary and a beautiful two-volume edition of the poetry of C.P. Kavafi. The second time I felt like anything but an adult, a girl in old woman's clothing, an imposter, climbing up and down the steep paths of the island every morning with the real old women, all of us dressed in black, all of us looking for kindling. The fallen wood was slick and wet. It was the worst winter anyone could remember. My husband, the first one, was very sick. The kalivi we were renting was cold and damp. And the only thing I could find to start a fire were old Playboy magazines, the paper also slick and wet. I hated my husband. I hated being married. We hated each other, the idea having been that coming to Skiathos would save us from our misery. You will find no new lands. You will find no other seas. So Kavafi wrote of Alexandria in the city. Book in hand, I looked back at myself, book in hand. In between came the part of my life called Time Passes. The first section of To the Lighthouse occupies only a single day, all of it spent delving into the psyche of each of the central characters, rolling them into a great teeming ball of psyches like the shawl around the skull of the beast in the nursery bedroom. Its governing question is deceptively simple. Will it be possible to make a trip to the lighthouse tomorrow? Mrs. Ramsey says, yes, of course, if it's fine. And her son James is filled with an extraordinary joy until his father shows up. It won't be fine, Mr. Ramsey says, looking out the window. The day could be fine. The day could be not fine. The day could be both things at once. When I was a girl of 16 in Philadelphia who thought she was an adult, my first encounter with Virginia Woolf was like that day, fine and not fine. The only thing I knew about her came from the title of Edward Albee's play, which some of us had considered putting on until we were told it wouldn't be appropriate. When I asked my English teacher what the title meant, he handed me a copy of To the Lighthouse. "You'll like this," he said. "It's difficult. She writes about difficult human relationships." Following the bilious confusion of Durrell, Virginia Woolf's language, which, despite the complexity of her sensibility, is remarkably clean and clear, entered my soul, to steal her imagery, like a beak. I didn't need a dictionary to read this book, nor did it drive me to the thesaurus. I didn't need to have experienced true love or sex or marriage or parenthood or old age or death, subjects I continued to write about energetically, cluelessly, to make a powerful connection with it. I think this was possible because, despite the book's interest in these matters, the dark, drumming heart of it, the place I remember best from when I first read it, and the place I still return to with quickening breath, is the shortest and weirdest section, the section that announces itself to be, by virtue of its title and everything in it, pure transition. I was an adult. I'd read the Alexandria Quartet. I'd gone to Europe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.